just check that you have the latest version available, which should say pushed lecture version on GitHub as the commit message. Feel free to follow along during the lecture with the notebook on your machine. And if you prefer not to, that's also fine. So I'll get started then. All right, is my screen visible?
Yes.
All right, great. So, hi everyone. Welcome to lecture 3. My name is Vedant. I'm a final year undergrad in the engineering physics department. I should say physics department. Anyways, so today we're going to be doing quite a lot of things, in fact. We're going to be doing exception handling. We're going to have a small introduction to classes. And then Aditya will take over and he will sort of show you around how to use documentations with a few examples from a library called ITER Tools. Okay, so let's get started. As always, post your questions on Slido. I'll stop in the middle for a few questions and we can probably address a few of them on the lecture itself. But we have the moderators on Slido ready to answer your questions. So please direct them there. All right. So exception handling. Hopefully, most of you have tried solving the tutorials, and during that process, you may have seen something similar to this colorful message on Jupyter telling you error. So if you ever wondered what it is or how you can interpret it or why does this come up, that's what we'll basically be doing for the first part of today's lecture. We'll see how we can anticipate these errors and also how we can use them in code. You heard that right. We'll actually use them and not just avoid them actively. So yeah, the first kind of error that you can get on Python is a syntax error. So this would be something like if you did print space hello world like this. Since Python 3, print is a function, which means you have to pass this inside parentheses. So if you do something like this, it'll just give you syntax error and it'll show you missing parentheses in call to print. Did you mean to print something like this instead? So this is in fact an error in syntax. Python cannot understand what exactly you meant when you typed out print like that. It has some idea, of course. That's why it gave this message like this. But basically, these are mistakes in the syntax itself. Now, the second kind of error is slightly more devious. Syntactically, they may be correct, but things will seem very fine. It'll look okay until you actually try to run it. So these are the kinds of things that the Python interpreter would understand, but it doesn't necessarily make sense to do something like that. A very simple example that we can give right now is where we have a tuple here of three elements, and we try to index append this with some value. Now, as you all know, tuples are immutable. That's what makes them different from lists, for example. So if you try to do something like an append, Python will throw an error saying, oh no, this tuple object has new attribute called append. There is no real problem in syntax over here. Syntactically, all of these are fine. It's just that when you actually run the program, it doesn't really make sense. And that's why Python throws an exception like this. So this particular one is called an attribute error. The tuple that has no attribute called append. We'll come in a bit more detail to what attribute means here. But basically, it's just saying that you can't append to a tuple, which makes sense. We know this. How do you fix this? Easy. You don't make it a tuple. Now, it's completely fine, except it's not a tuple anymore. But the name here doesn't really make much difference. Okay. So now everything is completely fine. Python is happy. We are happy. The next is a kind of indentation error. And now if you're getting a bit bored through all these errors, don't worry, we'll go through them quite fast. The purpose of today's lecture is to learn how to deal with them, not necessarily all the types of errors. This might come up quite a lot, especially if you're using a text editor for your programs. In Jupyter, if you usually go with a tab, you should be fine. But if you have indentation which is inconsistent like this, Python will tell you, oh no, there's some unexpected indent here. And if you fix that, then pretty straightforward. A different error, but something similar, happens if you mix tabs and spaces. Now again, Jupyter auto converts tabs to 4 spaces, so it should not be a problem on your notebooks. But if you are writing it on a text editor which does not do this, for example, and you have code that mixes tabs and indentations, tabs and spaces for your indentation, then Python will give you something called a tab error, and then that will, you know, that will create problems for you. The next is an index error. Now remember what the tuple was. Our tuple had 3 elements, so if we try to index it with a third element, it will say tuple index out of range, which basically means that there's not enough elements in the tuple for you to get the item at index 3, which will be 4. You'll need 4 elements for that to happen. Key error, similar sort of thing, but with dictionaries. Dictionaries are the things which have keys. So yeah, happiness does not exist here anymore. Name error happens when you run something which has a variable which is not defined yet. So it'll basically tell you that this variable name is not defined and that you should go ahead and do it somewhere in your code. Type error happens when you try to do something with types that aren't supposed to mix that way. So for example, if you do 3 plus 2, that is fine. If you do 3 string plus 2 as a string, then it'll give you this. It'll append it. But if you try to mix these, it'll tell you type error, you can only concatenate a string, not an integer, to another string. One thing to note here, and this is, I mean, pretty straightforward. You can understand what's going on here. If you exchange these, the error message that you get is significantly different. It says unsupported operand type for plus, int and string. And we'll sort of see why these two things are different when we come to classes. So there are a few, you know, references to classes quite early on in the lecture. But I mean, don't worry, we'll go through all of those in detail. Unbound local error usually happens when you reference an object before defining it inside a function or something like this, or inside a code block. This will tell you, oh no, look, you've referenced local variable X before actually assigning it some value. So if you just interchange this, put it up here, now there is no problem anymore. Great. Value error is the sort of, you know, sort of standard sort of thing that happens. The value of the list that you give here is wrong. This list has 4 elements and you are only unpacking for 3, which is why when you run it, Python will tell you there are too many values to unpack. We expected 3. So if you give it 3, it'll be completely fine. If you give it 2, it'll tell you not enough values to unpack. We expected 3, but we only really got 2. So these are sort of, you know, I mean, you have to go and sort of look in your code to understand why this happened. Zero division error, well, pretty straightforward. So how do you handle this situation, right? So we've already seen if statements, for loops, functions, all sorts of things that change the control flow of a program. Now we're going to see another one. This is called a try except block. So what happens here is that suppose we have defined a dictionary. When you say try, Python tries to interpret whatever is inside this block here, the try block. We call this the try block. Try block. If some sort of error comes up, then it goes to the except block. So here, this is basically what happens. The dictionary only has a key called sad. So when you try to get dictionary of happy, the dictionary does not have that key. So it raises a key error. And because it raised that error, it goes to the print statement here and runs this code. So you can sort of see why, I mean, even if there is a exception like this coming up in your program, you can sort of still get the program to run and do something sensible instead of, you know, just crashing completely. Great. Now, a general note here. Using a bare except like this, this is what is called a bare except, is generally a bad idea. And to show why it's a bad idea, we are going to do some live coding. Okay, can you see the terminal over here? I'm not sure if you can.
Yeah, it's visible.
All right, cool. So let's make a program. For those of you who haven't actually gone beyond Jupyter Notebooks till now, this is how you actually run a Python script, right, on Ubuntu or Mac or whatever. Even Windows, if you use the command shell, you can do something like this. Okay, so we are going to print a lot of stuff. Okay, so the stuff that we are going to print. Let's find something a bit more reasonable. Great. In fact, let's just put zero. Let's have a infinite loop. And inside that infinite loop, we will print stuff. Well, it seems reasonable enough, right? Except that I just said that it's an infinite loop. So if you try to run this, it'll print zero a lot. It looks like it did nothing, but if you scroll up, you'll see a lot of zeros up there. So now what we'll do is we'll go, and if you notice, the way I stopped it was to press Control plus C. Right? So that's how I stopped this program, and it calls something called a keyboard interrupt, which is great when you want to stop runaway programs. But now what if we put this inside a bare try except? So we try to print stuff, right? Except we will make stuff equal stuff, one minus stuff. So whenever an error comes up, and you can imagine, like, there's no scope for an error to come here, right? But if it does, then stuff will become one. And if something happens again, then stuff will become zero, and so on and so on. Okay. So now when we try to run this, I'm pressing Control C quite a lot. But as you can see, it just goes from 0 to 1, 0 to 1. And that's because the keyboard interrupt is interpreted by Python to be something similar to an exception, which means if you have a runaway loop inside your program, you can't stop it. Now, this is just a very contrived example, but you know, the real problems obviously happen when the error that happened in your code block here was not the error that you predicted that you could solve with this except block, right? So for example, if you expected some index error to happen, but instead it was some value error somewhere that actually happened in the program, your except block would not deal with that well. So what we'll do here instead is we will actually tell Python which error we are expecting, and only when that error comes up to go to the try except block. Otherwise it will just, you know, deal with it as usual. So let's put some error here. I mean, it doesn't really matter which. And now when you try to run it, the Control C works. It only deals with the error that we tell it to, and everything is fine. So this is how you should be really writing the program that is up there. If there is a key error, then print, there is no key called happy here. Great. So let's take a look at a sort of, you know, better example of this. We have some fraction of polynomials here, x squared minus 1 by x minus 1. This is obviously not defined at x equal to 1, but it has a limit at x equal to 1, and that is 2, which you can see if you just factorize the numerator, you get x plus 1 times x minus 1, cancel out the x minus 1, and you get x plus 1, which evaluated at 1 is 2. Okay. So if you try to do this just like this, Python will tell you, oh no, there's a zero division error. How do we deal with this? We already know how to deal with this. We try to return this, except if there is a zero division error, in which case return 2, because we know that the limit here is 2. And this is the program, and this is the value that makes sense for our program. And if we try to do this, ta-da, we have now used the zero division error, which was giving us a headache here, And instead of trying to avoid it, we have actually used it and made our program better. You can also raise your own errors, by the way. So if you define a function called square root like this, if x less than 0, you can raise a value error and say that if you give this pass this a string to value error or any error like this, this is what will be printed out in the error message, right? If x is less than 0, raise this error. And if it's not, then it'll just continue on the program. It'll return x raised to 0.5. So if you do square root of 1, everything's fine. If you try square root of minus 1, you get value error, square root of negative numbers not defined for reals. Of course, you can do more than this. So here, for example, if you try this, it'll give you a type error. This is not something that you expected would happen, right? I mean, when you wrote the program, no. Type errors were not something you accounted for here. So you can also check if input can be converted to a float or an int. If so, then continue the program. If not, then raise another error, like a type error or something. Those are all things you can do, and I'll leave those up to you. Okay, so I'll stop here for a few questions and give you a bit of a summary. If you want to handle exceptions, use a try except block. Do not use a bare except under any circumstances, unless, of course, you don't really care what error comes your way and you just want to run some part of the program. Additional things to look up. Try except else finally is basically the expanded version of try except. It will try something in a block. If an error comes up, it will do whatever is there in the except block. If the error doesn't come up, it will do whatever is there in the else block. And at the end, finally, regardless of whether the error came up or not, it will do the finally block. So this we'll sort of leave as an exercise, or we'll give you as a tutorial for you to understand better. We won't really discuss it much in the class right now. Handling multiple errors, you can just put multiple except blocks and you can handle multiple errors like that. We've gone 20 minutes. So I'll stop here. Are there any questions on Slido that you think we should be answering here?
No, Vedant, right now there are no any questions.
Okay, great. Any issues with the slides or the font? Oh, that was for the terminal. Oh, sorry. It was just a demonstration.
When you run the terminal, then.
Okay, cool. I should have thought of that. It's cool now. So last chance for questions, because now we're moving on to classes and we'll only come back to exception handling maybe at the end of the class, if at all. Any questions?
Can I go a bit slow?
Yes, I will go a bit slow here in classes because we will be discussing an example from the tutorial. All right. Okay, so let's start then. Classes. So I will sort of assume that you've heard of an object-oriented programming. We won't really cover what it is in today's class because, well, we want to talk about classes. So if you do know what object-oriented programming is, great. If you don't know, just know that everything you see in Python is an object. What is an object? Object is something that has attributes, it has methods. It follows some sort of template. And that template is what is called a class. So a class is sort of like a template for data structures. They have attributes. You can access this with a dot. You've seen this before. I'll tell you exactly where you've seen this before. You have seen this, for example, with dot split, right? So all of these things there where you have this sort of dot operator coming in is where you're accessing an attribute of an object. Right. The attribute, of course, can be some data, or it can be a function that does something to that object. In the case of the string, it splits the string and gives you substrings, split by whatever delimiter you gave it there. Now, an easy way of looking at what attributes something has is using this dir function. I call it dir. I'm not entirely sure what it's how it's supposed to be pronounced. You can see there's a lot of stuff going on here, but you can probably recognize quite a few of them. For example, you can see join here, you can see lower, you can find split, you can find strip, all of these things which you have seen. I mean, this is a very good way of, you know, finding out what sort of attributes and methods a particular object has. So you can, for example, see that strings have some a method called capitalize. Try to find out what that is. How do you do that? Just run a cell and run capitalize. Okay. So let's use the example of tutorial 1, question 6, to sort of understand how classes work in Python, why you would want to use them, and how you can use them. So this was the question. So basically, you have to redefine the plus, minus, multiplication, and the division operators to do something else, right? This was really complicated. You can do this with a bunch of if statements. You can do this with a dictionary. You know, all sorts of solutions are possible. What we will try to do here is get a method to redefine the plus, minus, multiplication, and so on using classes. And this will use something that, if you have done C++ before, you might be familiar with, called operator overloading. And we'll come to that in a while. So the first thing that we have to do is we have to define some sort of class. Now, I like to sort of develop from like ground up, right? So that this is the basic thing that you can do. You have a class. Each class has a name. This is a very uninformative name. I should have called this like complicated number or something, but I don't want to type out that much. So I'll just call it number. This is what is called a doc string. And it's basically what you see when you look up like the documentation and stuff on Jupyter. You know, you can put a question mark and run the cell. You will see doc strings that describe what a function or a class does. Okay. So the first thing that we see here is this double underscore init, or as I will start calling it now, dunder init. Dunder stands for double underscore. Now what this does is it initializes an instance of this class with, you know, it runs this set of instructions that are here inside this block. So what it does is it does self.value equal value. What does that mean? It means that it defines an attribute, a data attribute called value, and instantiates it with whatever you pass in to the class. So when you define it, so if you have num, this is an instance of the class. Number is the actual class, and you're passing 2. So the value here is 2. Number is the name of the class. You notice that you don't see this double underscore in it, and that is because this is a special method in Python, and it basically does some magic behind the scenes so that you can use it like this instead of using, you know, something like this. Okay. So great. Now this means that now the instance of the class number called num has an attribute called value, and that value is 2. If it doesn't, you know, strike you how this would be useful for our problem, stick with it for a little bit. Okay. Now, okay. So just bear with me for a while, you know, this self thing is going on here. Some of you might be wondering, there are 2 arguments to this function here. Where did the first one go? The self here describes the instance of the class itself. Okay. And that's why when you write num.value, it gives 2. Whereas we, here in this case, we wrote self.value equal value, right? So we'll actually see where self comes in some of the functions in the next example. So now that we have some sort of a data attribute, we want to make a method. In this case, the method we call print value, and that prints something saying, hello, I am whatever the value it is, okay? Note that if you used value here, Python doesn't know what value means in the scope of this function. Right, and that's where classes start to be useful. You can have data and methods which use those data, right? Which is not really accessible otherwise. Great. So we'll define num equal number 2 again, and we run this. And now again, you might be seeing this. There is one argument for this function here, but here we are not giving any. And the reason for that is what is happening here is somewhat similar to this. You have number, which is the class dot print value, and it's passing num into it. So that is what is sort of meant when you have this parameter called self here. Is there anything special about self? No, you can use basically any variable name that you want, as long as you're willing to get shouted at by the internet. So self is something that is, how would you put it? Extensively enforced convention. So yeah, use self, people use self, people know what you mean when you use self. Now, these are a few things which in the beginning you may have to sort of take at face value until you get used to using it. But once you do so, you'll find that it's pretty nice. It gives you a lot of power to do a lot of things, including changing the attributes. So if you have a number like this, you can, in fact, outside the class, change the value to 3. And in this case, so here if we do num.printValue, you'll notice that Python auto tab and completes it, tab completes this for me, which is nice. This happens on Jupyter. If you make the num value 3, then it will in fact go and change the value of this self.value in the instance to 3. And the string that you'll get will be hello, I am 3. So pretty straightforward. Now, there is a way for you to sort of use another dunder method here. Suppose you write num, okay? What you get is this weird thing. Now, what this is that this is the type of num, and it's saying that it's stored at some memory location. I mean, this would be fine if you were a computer, but you're not, you're a human. You sort of want to know what this thing really is. And you get that when you do if a equal to 2 and you do a, you get this very nice 2. You don't get int at some random location, right? And the way to do that is to use something called a wrapper. Now, if you add a double underscore wrapper like this and you return a string, then whatever will print when you just ask for an output here will be that string. So if you want to say this is a complicated number, right? This is what will happen. And now you can print it and it'll say, oh, this is a complicated number that has a value of 2. Okay. So if you want to add 2 instances of number, which is what we started to do, right? We started to make this really big calculator before we got lost in inits and wrappers and selfs. Suppose we want to add this. So I'll change this class. I'll keep the init, I'll keep the wrapper, because obviously we want to see a nice wrapper. I'll define a new method called add. I'll obviously pass in self. I'll pass in this other thing. This again is not really a convention. It's not really as heavily encouraged. You can put another complicated number, right? But other is short enough that people can understand what's going on. So what's happening is you're passing another instance of this variable, of this class, sorry. And you're doing this very complicated addition that we have defined earlier. So it's taking self.value raised to other.value plus other.value raised to self.value, which means that when you have number 1 is equal to number with the value 2 and num 2 is equal to number with the value 3, if you do num1.addNum2, you will get 17. Great. I mean, this is great. This is very close to what we wanted to do. Can we do better though? Python has a way of adding numbers or adding data types. It's called the plus operator. Now, if you want to directly use the plus operator here, I mean, you can't, right? If you try it, it will tell you. Bonus point if you guess what error is going to come up here. It's a type error. It says unsupported operand types for plus, number, and number, which basically means we haven't defined what plus means when you have complicated numbers or for this class, right? So how do we do that? Now, we've seen a few dunder methods till now. Let's find a few more. Now, let's look at all of the methods for int. You'll see that there are a lot of them. Notice a few. add, if you look down here, you will see A, B, C, D, E, F, G, MUL. Okay, you'll see sub somewhere here if you look. Yep, and you'll also see true div. These sort of represent the operations that the operators plus minus asterisk and forward slash do in Python, right? So as an example, let's have two integers. And if we want to do A plus B, we get 3. By what we saw right now, if we try to do A dot dunder add B, we should still get 3. And indeed we do. Now what we saw earlier, right, when we did the print value, where we didn't necessarily use the instance dot print value, we did the class dot print value and pass the instance to it. If you try that, then you'll get this. And this also works because int is a class. A and B are instances of that class. They are objects, right? Python is an object-oriented programming language. And if you try the same sort of argument passing with int dot double under add, things will work just as you expected. Which means that in our original class, we can just add two double underscores before and after this, and we will finally get what we've been looking for so long. Ta-da, magic. It is extremely powerful. You can overload any operator that you want. You can overload the plus, you can overload minus, the asterisk, you can, which is the multiplication operator. You can overload the exponentiation, you know, or any operator that you really want, you can do that. So we've overloaded adds, all true div. These all do the things that I defined in those equations there. So if you run this, we get num1 equal to number 2, num2 equal to number 3, and moment of truth, yep, it works. If you want, you can verify this, but I can tell you that they're right. And we have actually implemented that calculator using a class called number. So that's sort of the basic sort of introduction to classes. We saw how we can write a class. We saw that classes can have data attributes. They can have methods. You can overload stuff using this these dunder methods. There's a lot more to classes. Of course, we haven't talked about something called inheritance or subclassing. Those of you who have coded in C++ or have done CS 101, might feel like we haven't covered that. But this was just an introduction to the basics of classes. And so as a summary, classes are fun, they're nice to use. Classes have methods, which are also fun, very nice to use. Privacy, this is something we didn't do. So in C++ or in Java, you can have protected or private variables. There's nothing like that in Python. Everything here you can take out, you can change the value. You saw how we changed the value of the number earlier. So for example, here you can just do num1.value equal 4 instead, and everything will run with num1 as 4 instead of 2, right? So everything in Python, all of these data attributes, all of the methods, all of them are exposed to public. You can do whatever you want with them outside the class, and nobody can stop you. And we can use dunder methods to overload operators. Now, obviously, there is a lot of things we haven't covered yet because, again, introductory session, we would obviously want to sort of show you how to use documentation. That was the more prime focus of this lecture. But there are a lot of very cool things that we haven't covered and that we might cover during the tutorials. So those include property, which is when you want to sort of regulate how people interact with the data attributes inside your class. So for example, if you don't want people to change value randomly, because I can put value equal to string 4 here, and nothing will, the class will not complain. It hasn't been told that this can't be a string. Except when you try to do this, it'll give you all sorts of type errors, right? So either you can put this inside a big try except block and then tell Python, if something like this does come up, then we think we know what it might be. Or you can regulate the way in which people outside the class can deal with the data types. So that's one way you can do that is using properties. There are a lot of other cool things, including subclassing, which is great. And if you want to dive into this, I would highly recommend going and watching this YouTube video, which is about 45 minutes long. It's a bit longer than this class up till now, but it goes through a lot of these slightly advanced but very useful topics. So yeah, if you want to understand classes in more detail, here is where you should go. By the way, this the speaker here is Raymond Hettinger. He's a core Python core developer. His lectures are very good. There are a few of them up on YouTube. Go watch every single one of them. Okay. All right. Yes, I said I would stop for questions, so I will. I'll stop sharing. Yeah. Questions?
Currently, we don't have any questions. All the questions are being answered by the moderator.
Okay. Somebody has a doubt on
wait
chat.
Wait for 1 minute and we can start with the next question, at least.
Okay. Somebody has a doubt on chat, though.
I don't know. Okay.
Okay. Cool, cool. Fine then. Should we go ahead with the safe quiz right now? By the way, I'll be going on Slido right now. So, I mean, if you want.
Oh, yeah. Let's get to.
All right, so we'll have the safe quiz now. So guys, get your devices ready. We'll be sharing the passwords.
Do you want me to share screen again?
Yeah, can you share screen to like the motion part? I'll just paste the password there. Or maybe Aditya can share since he's continuing, right?
Yeah, sure, sure. Great.
I'll do that in a moment. Just a second. Do you see the screen?
Yes.
Yes? Okay, good. Just let me know what the answer is. You can type it in.
Okay guys, sharing the password now. I hope everyone is ready. So the name and the password are up on the screen. Please start the question. Aditi, can you unshare and share once? It seems a lot of people can't see the screen for some reason.
Is that fine now?
Yeah, I can see it. If someone still can't see it, please leave and rejoin the meet. So Aditya, most of the people have submitted the quiz. So I guess we can move forward. People who are lagging behind, please finish the quiz soon.
All right. We can wait for 1 minute, I think. Or like, should we start? You have the stats, right? Most people are done.
Yeah, most people are done. But yeah, you can wait for like 1 minute or 30 seconds.
We can leave them gazing at a meme for a minute. Okay, I think we'll start. That's okay, right, Shivam?
Yeah, we can start.
Okay, great. So, hello everyone. My name is Aditya. I'm a third year mechanical student. And I'll be taking you through this very interesting topic of documentation. And it's kind of ideological more than a coding oriented part. So it's about an approach on how to solve the various problems that you would encounter. Okay. So it's not going to be that much coding, but we'll try to take an example of a very, very useful module called IDA tools. And we'll see how it goes. Okay, so reading documentation is where we start. So this meme puts it very aptly that people have this general impression that Python's documentation is pretty abstract and difficult to read or make sense of. But if you know how to use it properly, then it can be a very good help as you learn Python, especially as you're in the learning stage. Okay. So the question that a lot of people ask is documentation the best way to learn Python? Like, is that self-sufficient? And if we have documentation, can we understand Python entirely? And the answer to that would be no. It is a great reference when you want to know what a specific module does. So this example is actually very helpful. So the question that you usually have in your mind would be, how do I split a string into a list of individual words? So this is something you need. Documentation is not going to answer this question directly. What documentation will tell you is you can open this documentation for the string module and list out all the functions in that module. Which of them helps to split a string into a list of individual words? You would have to look among those functions and find out. So whenever you're using documentation, make sure that you have your question right. Okay. So with that, let's
can you zoom in a bit?
Okay.
Yeah,
are we better now?
Yeah, that's better.
Great. Okay. Cool.
Okay. I hope I didn't. So you didn't miss anything. If anyone did not understand, it's basically that we'll explore how to use documentation and what kind of questions you ask when you want to learn something using documentation. Okay. Everything related to documentation can be found at this official place, which is this link. And these notes will be uploaded later, so you can always go and refer to it. Otherwise, it's docs.python.org. And there are a lot of other websites that have useful stuff, but this is the official documentation. So for some of the lesser known functions, you would find stuff only there. And once you go there, you're only a search away from the module you want to know about. I can actually open it up. Yeah, so this is how it looks, and you can
search for whatever you want, and you would get this is what we're going to do.
Okay. Then what else? Okay, so the question I want to leave you with is, you over the last week or two, you might have come across a lot of words: module, package, library, even framework. So these are a lot of the words that you've come across, and you might be wondering, what is the difference between these? Are they the same thing or not? And again, I've linked a very good answer to this question, and you can actually read it and find out what the subtle differences are between some of these things, some of these terms that are used interchangeably. Okay, so much of that. Let's get back to IDA tools. So again, this would open the documentation. I already have it here. Okay, so this is how classic documentation looks, and IDA tools is well documented. So that's why, and it's a very useful module as well. So there is some introduction regarding what this does. So let's cut straight to it. So there are member functions. So this lists each of those functions. They're classified in different categories. It lists the arguments, and it kind of explains what the function does very crudely. And if you click on this, you would see that there is a detailed explanation on how the function is actually written, how it roughly works if you were to write it in simpler code. Okay. Usually this part is sufficient to understand what the function is all about. So for example, let's look at this function count. So what does count do? You provide it an argument start, and then you provide it an optional argument step. And what it does is it returns an infinite sequence. Start, the next number is start plus step, then goes on and on. It's like an arithmetic progression.
If that is no, so this the argument in square brackets is optional. So there is a default value, which is 1. So if you just pass the argument 10, which is start, and you don't pass any step argument, it would return a sequence 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, so on. Okay. That's all the function does. So you didn't have to look it up elsewhere. The documentation was good enough to tell you what the function does. Okay. So this is how we'll try to go through some more functions from here. All right. So what is IdaTools anyway? So it contains a lot of useful functions that serve as iterators for efficient looping. So I hope you remember what an iterator is from previous sessions. It's basically something you can loop over. So it's kind of like a counter. That's the crudest way to put it. Okay. Anyway, whether you understand that or not, you will certainly understand all these functions. So let's take this example. So I have a Jupyter notebook open. Okay. So let's do this. Is a notebook font okay? Should I zoom in, zoom out?
Zoom in a bit.
Are we fine now?
Nothing changed on our end yet. Oh yeah, it's fine now.
It's fine? Okay, great. Okay, so this is an example of how do we use the count function in a for loop. Before that, what is this jargon here? Especially what is this part? So very often when you use packages, libraries, and modules, you have to import them. And similar to what you would use the keyword include in C++, it's just to include something externally that is not loaded by default. Okay, so that's about import, and this is the name of the module. So this is fine. What is this as IT? So this is an alias. So Python provides this. So remember, if you were not going to use this alias, you would have to call, as pointed out previously, these are member functions. So you would have to write idertools.count. Every time you use a function from this module, you would have to write idertools.whatever. So to make that easy, lazy Python engineers have just used this aliasing, which allows you to call. So it's literally what it sounds like. So you can import this by the name of IT, simple. So every time I use IdaTools, I can just say IT.com. Speaking of import, there is another useful way to do it. Let me just run this first. So, okay, so what does this do? For I in, this is an iterable, what is it? 10, 5. Remember, 10 is my, I have two iterables. Yeah. 10 is my start and 5 is a step. So I should have a sequence 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, 35, 40, 45, so on. What does a loop do? Obviously, that would be infinite. If I were to print I, it would just be an infinite thing, and I would have to interrupt it using keyboard interrupt or whatever. So I say that whenever I reaches 40, just break and get out of the loop, stop it right there. So you would expect the sequence to be terminated at 35. And you run it, that's what happens. Okay, so that's about count, very elementary. Let us, so I want to also bring to your attention how else you can import. So if you were to import this way, obviously I need to run it, it was already done. So let's say that I imported it as, let's do it differently. From IdaTools, import count. Okay, so what would this do? So before I actually do this, let me comment out. What if I just said count? Why do I have to call this IT? Yep. So count makes no sense unless you tell Python that this is not any random count. This is not a variable called count or a function called count. It is a member function of the IdaTools module. That's what IT.count would have told. There's another way to do it. If you don't want to put IT.count and you're just importing one function, you can also import just that one function. How would you do that? From module library package name, import that specific function. So if I say from IdaTools import count, so it says I don't want IdaTools, I just want that one function from IdaTools and that's all. So I don't need to alias it, I don't need anything, I just want that one function. Now if I do this, it's fine. So it knows that what count is, it is a member function from IdaTools. Okay, so both these things signify the same thing, although we generally prefer to just call it in general because you don't know what other functions you might need later on. Okay, so that was a quick side note about import. Let's get back to IT2. Let's try to look at another function. Cycle. What does cycle say? It takes an argument P, and then it says P0, P1, all the way up to P last, and then it repeats. Best way to understand what this is, cycle ABCD. So this is also an IEEE inside. So there are four characters. And what it does is P0 is A, so it starts with the first member, which is A, then B, A, B, C, D, it reaches the last. And then it goes back to the start and continuously produces the sequence. So it's an infinite sequence, but it's recurrent as compared to this, which is like an arithmetic progression. So you can think of areas where this would be useful. Can we have an example? So again, an iterable need not just be a string, it could also be a list. Let's go right here. And we run it. And you see that we have this list containing 6 and 9. There's also a counter to prevent this from going on forever. So this just runs the loop for 10. So you would have 6, 9, so 3 would become 0, 1, 2. And then for the third, it would be 3 as well. And then after that, it would exit the loop. So it would print 4 times. Again, very easy to see. It's just some utility of the specific function. Again, we're not focusing specifically on IT tools. We're focusing on how to read documentation and understand something. So something that is new to you, yet you have reasonable mastery over it just by reading the documentation and kind of implementing the examples here. So this way you have the power to learn almost any library or any module. That's a big thing that I just said. Okay, let's look at another function. Repeat. This is by far the easiest one. Its first argument is the thing that you want repeated. And the second optional argument is how many times you want it repeated. So if you don't specify the second argument, it becomes an infinite iterator. So what is an infinite iterator? One that is capable of generating an infinite sequence. So here, this can be infinite or terminating, depending on whether the last argument is there or not. So repeat 10, 3 would just give 10 three times. If I were to omit this argument, I would get an infinite sequence of 10. Again, pretty easy. This is a very useful application of this utility. So what is this setup? I hope you're familiar with maps. So what this does is basically this is used to apply a function. This is one of the utilities of map is to apply a function to a list of numbers here, for example. So what this does is, this is the base and this is the exponent. So this is how the power function works. I'm pretty sure you guys are familiar with this even from C++. So what range 10 does is it produces a sequence of numbers 0, 1, 2, all the way up to 9. Okay, again, I hope you're familiar with this. What do I want to do? My task is I want to exponentiate all of these numbers. I want to square all these numbers, pretty basically. So I want the square of the first 9 numbers. Without using further advanced tools like NumPy, where you would be able to do it in one go, this is a nice way to do that in one line. What does this do? So for each of these numbers, I would like a 2, because that's the exponent I want for each of these numbers. So ideally, I would like a sequence of 2s here, which is an iterable. Okay, how do I generate a sequence of 2s that's an iterable? Well, I just use it.repeat2. And the question you might be asking me is, we have 10 bases here, so we should have 10 exponents, right? So why didn't I say this? Well, there's no need to do that when this can say. So it clips on the number of bases. So if I have 10 bases, it only considers 10. All arguments are all 2s after that are not going to make any sense. So what do we expect? We should expect obviously a list of squares. And remember, every time this, so to display maps, to display other iterables, it's best to use a list so you get it in the output format that is easily visible. Okay, so it's a different data type. So converting it to a list is very convenient for you to see it right here. Okay. I hope this is fine. So this was about infinite iterators. This is still very basic. So this is not exploiting the real power of the IdaTools library. Before we move ahead, any questions, anything at all? Shubham or anyone else, is there anything pressing? Anyone else, any of the mods who are here, is there anything pressing?
You can probably just point out how to alias something. So
okay.
Somebody has asked if you can import from IdaTools, import from IdaTools, import count as something, which, yeah, can
you show? Fine. Want me to show that? Okay, I can do that. Yep. I hope this is visible. So again, I can always use the aliasing here as well. If I don't want to type count, I can just add an alias and then I can use it wherever I want. So whoever had that question, I hope this clarifies. So aliasing always works with importing. However, you whether you import a function or whether you import the module or library directly. Okay. So that was fine. Okay. So let's move on to the more exciting part of IdaTools. So we have a very interesting tutorial problem lined up later on. Okay, so this is combinatoric iterator, and this might take you back to some of your JE concepts. And a lot of those questions can be solved very nicely using combinatoric iterators. Let's actually look at it from here. What does it do? In fact, they're very good examples here. So the product function takes PQ as arguments and returns a Cartesian product. So what is a Cartesian product? Well, let's take an example here. So this is an iterable again. So A, B, C, D is an iterable. And repeat 2. So what does repeat 2 do? Well, it's very easy to see here. So what would all the possible Cartesian products be? For size 2, you would have AA, AB, AC, AD. It's easy to see that there would be, what, 16 of them. Right, that's about product. So this is, so how would you do it otherwise? You would have to have a nested for loop, right? So you would have to have one loop outside that I goes from 0 to whatever, 0 to 3, and then J goes from 0 to 3, and you would have to take one character and do something like that if you were to do it without using IdaTools. So that would be one. So this is a very, in fact, all four of these are very weak functions that you can use. What else? Permutations, combinations with replacement, all self-explanatory. Best way is to look at an example. So that's why another reason why documentation is so useful when you're learning something for the first time. Permutations, as you understand, the only thing here is that AB and BA are considered different as compared to combinations, where it's just about choosing two characters from these four, that's all. Again, something you're familiar with, and you can actually test it out here. Combinations with replacement, it allows you to sample the same character multiple times. So in addition to this, you would also have AA, BB, CC, and DD. Okay. This somehow reminds people of grades all of a sudden, sort of chosen a different example. Okay. Just for the sake of doing it in front of you, I'm also going to run this one. Here you go. What would you expect? Quick exercise. So this is a different thing. So here I have two of them. So here, when I didn't specify a second argument, it did a self-Cartesian product. So ABCD multiplied, so as multiplied by ABCD. So when I specify two, then it is a proper Cartesian product. So it would take one, it would be capital A, small a, capital A, small b, capital A, small c, and so on. Permutations, the rest of them are pretty self-explanatory, just same as that. Let me copy it to Jupyter. I have done already. Yeah. As expected, for the first one, product is, I could have formatted it a bit better. Sorry about that. Product is as expected. Permutations. permutations A, B, B, A. Here you don't have that allowed. It's just three of them. Therefore, you would have six permutations, six of them, correct? Three combinations. And then with replacement, you would end up having A, B, B, and C, C in addition to. Very simple, but very useful. So if you want to generate sequences like this. So a lot of problems, again, you will see something very interesting in the tutorial that you can solve using this. A lot of problems that would be pretty complex to solve otherwise can be solved using some or all of these functions. Okay, more on that in the tutorial. Hopefully you will see a good question there. Okay, let's move on to another set of functions, which are the we are the terminating iterators. These are basically the others. They're not combinatoric, they're not infinite. So they have a finite kind of output, simple as that. Okay, what does, let's pick out one by one. This is accumulate. So let's look for accumulate here. Accumulate is here. Okay, what does it do? It says P, and there is an optional argument here. Let's just ignore that for the time being. So P is again an iterable, so it would have have P0, P1, so it's like a list or a string. Here, addition, since we're considering addition, a list would make more sense. So what this does is, this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, very simple. It just adds numbers cumulatively. So you would have 1, 1 plus 2, 1 plus 2 plus 3, so on. And it would return this. Very efficient way of doing this task. You might have to set up a loop again if you wanted to do this. Otherwise, there are a lot of these small things that are very useful. So this is accumulate. Let's try to run it. Okay, what about the optional argument? The optional argument says func. So it means that it doesn't have to be plus. It doesn't have to be addition. It could also be another function. Let's look at that when we run it actually. Okay. So there we are. You notice something here. Let's ignore that for the time being. Okay, let's ignore all of this. Okay, so this is not aptly named, but okay, fine. Accumulate 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. In fact, it's the same example as there. This will be 1, 3, 6, 10, 15 as expected. Let's just run it. Yep, good. Now, what does this import operator do? So it allows us in a way to define what an operator is. So here, I can define a different operator that need not necessarily be plus. If I don't define anything, the default operator is addition here, so it would add cumulatively. Here, I import operator, and remember, I haven't aliased it. So if I have to call mul, which is a member of this module, which signifies multiplication. So I have to call it as operator.mul, okay? Otherwise I could have said from operator import mul. I would have done that. I hope you understand the whole idea of importing, aliasing, and like using the from import thing. Okay, so this would give me, so this would now have cumulative multiplication. So it would be 1, 2 factorial basically. So let's do it there. As expected, good. All right, let's go back. So that was about accumulate, very simple, but a lot of, there's a lot of use. So again, how would you have calculated a factorial? Normally, you would have probably had to use, apart from like built-in functions, you would have probably had to use recursion or a loop or something like that. So again, we do away with most of those stuff here. These are cute tricks to do a lot of useful stuff. Okay, chain, let's, ditch this and let's go to this place. This is the best place to understand how it works. Chain, very simple. Pass in multiple iterables or like multiple sequences, and it just kind of concatenates them. That's all. So you pass them A, B, C, D, E, F. So again, this is also an iterable. So you would have A, B, and C, D, E, and F, and it just produces a list sequence of the characters concatenate. Kind of chained to one another. So that's why, again, it's self-explanatory. Another example here. Yep. I'm going to start with our sorting it. So this is consonants, vowels, and I change consonants and vowels. So very simply, I would, again, this is a list instead of a string. I could do that either way. So I would just get these characters followed by these characters in a single sequence. Yep, as expected. Again, I'm making a list so that it is of the right data type to print out. And of course, once I get this, I can also sort it. This is just an additional one thing. That's all, nothing else. So once you sort it, you get everything sorted. So you can probably see areas where this can be of potential use. I hope there are no questions. If there are, I hope there are people on Slido to address it. So there's nothing pressing. Okay, compress. Interesting. Compress is a very, in fact, this is something that I really like. So what does this do? Again, that's the best place to understand it. Go here. What this does, data, it has two arguments, data and selector. And this is very interesting. This kind of gives away a lot about what the function does. So it says the first element of this, if the first element of this is true, which is what does true signify here? It's one. So if I have the first argument is ABCDEF, and my selectors are 101011. So if I want only select elements of this to go ahead, basically, if I want to filter out elements based on some pattern or some trend or given any sequence of ones and zeros, it's kind of like I'm superposing this filter over this, if you understand what I mean. So the characters on which there is a one, those are the only ones that make it out. The rest of them get dropped out. Very interesting. Let us take this here back into Jupyter. So these are five names of the instructors. And the ones that are teaching today are one and two. So if I want just these names to appear, I can pass this filter or the selector to 01001. And then id.compress does just that. So it gives me exactly those names that I want. Again, very useful in a lot of situations. That's about compress. Then let's move on to another. Let's look at a few more functions. Group by. Group by is very interesting again. What does group by do? Well, for group by, it's best to look at an example. So let's do it here. Let's just take this example. So what group by does is kind of produces, let me actually run it. That would be the best thing to do. Okay, let's run it and see what happens. So this is my word or the sequence of characters. And what it does is it groups by different characters. So if I have AA, BB, A, let's see what happens. Yeah, so it groups by contiguous characters. If you do this, it says there are A's, three of them, B's, three of them, C's, four of them, and then D. I put AA here, it would recognize another set of A's. It does not give you a frequency distribution or anything like that, because it treats these A's differently as compared to these A's. But all it does is it gives you extracts contiguous characters. So this can also be useful whenever you're passing a sequence, continuous sequence. This is also very useful. So it helps you group it by A's, then B, then C, then D. So what is key and group here? So key just refers to A, and group is this list of those A's. Same here, B, C, and D. Again, I hope you're familiar with this key group notation from before as well, in the last lecture. Again, another useful function. Let us move on. Okay, iSlice. iSlice is also interesting because, okay, let's look at it here. What does iSlice do? Let's look at this example. So iSlice, some sequence, two, and none. So what is that? So sequence, then we have, what do we have? We have a start and a stop and then step. All this could seem a bit complicated. The best way to look at it is using this example, that's all. So what does this do? A, B, C, D, E, F, J, two and none. So it starts from 2, 0, 1, 2, and this goes all the way up to the end. So you have C, D, E, F, J. Okay. Let us take another example. Okay. Here we go. What do you expect here? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 is my list. This is my list that I'm passing, the first argument. Start at one, okay. Start at one is zero and one, which starts here. Stop was the next one. Stops at six, which is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, non-inclusive, so this would not be printed. And what was the next one? That's step. So again, I hope you're familiar with step. So step is just, it skips. So two would give one, so it would start here. So you would have two, then four, then six, and stops. Okay. So 2, 4, 6, that's what you would expect, and that's what you get. What if I made this 5? So you should be able to see that. That's good. Let's work it out. 0, 1, so we start here. 5 is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So this is not inclusive, so it would not include 6. And it goes in steps of 2. So you start at 2, then go to 4. Can't do 6, so it should just be 2 and 4. Right? That's what it is. Again, pretty simple. So that was about islice. Last one we're looking at is last function.
Aditya, just sorry to interrupt here.
Yes,
so there are a few questions asking about like sticking to a notebook and stuff like that. So just to sort of point out that the focus of this lecture and all the lectures that will come after this is not to teach you about these specific functions, but to show you how to approach, for example, the documentation. So what you should be focusing on is how we are trying to understand what is written in the Python documentation itself, and not necessarily remember all the functions, what they do and their syntax and so on. So if you don't remember what chain or compress does, it is not an issue. The point that we're trying to make here is to sort of show you guys how we would approach understanding whatever is written on the screen. And then obviously, I mean, tinker around with code and sort of figure it out. In subsequent lectures, there will be a lot of material covered. But what you should keep in mind is that we are sort of showing you that things exist in Python and how you could possibly use them in the future. It will take a while for you to feel comfortable with it, and that will only happen with practice. So which is why we have the tutorials and the final project, etc. So if you feel like this is a lot to take in at a while, it's fine. You don't have to remember all the whole thing like right now or anything, right? Even us, we probably won't remember most of the functions in this. We'll have to refer to the documentation and Google and Stack Overflow and so on. So just pointing that out, yeah. Sorry, you can go on. Yeah.
Okay, great. Thanks. Just to add here, so I did not know much about ITIL tools a couple of days back. I went through this documentation while preparing for this lecture, and you look at it step by step, and I'm just taking you through how you would learn it for the first time. And this is very important because you would be learning a lot of new stuff over the next 2 weeks. So yeah, this is kind of to teach you how to learn rather than tell you that this function does this thing. Okay, great. As Vedant well pointed out well. Okay, good. One last function, this is called zip longest. And again, another thing that I want you to notice is how optional arguments are used. So basically, how do you read? So there are a lot of these things that it doesn't cry out immediately that this is an optional argument. So when you read documentation, this is a standard notation. So you need to be comfortable with these kind of things rather than exactly what the function does. Okay, moving on. Zip longest. What this does, again, very easy. You have two lists or two iterables of different lengths. So this is interesting. So what if I want to take one element from, so if I want to match the first element and the first element here, and the second, similar to how zip works in general. If you are aware of how zip works in general in Python, if not, look it up. Documentation again. What this does is it takes the first element from here and the first element from here, puts them together, and returns the first element of the output. Then, so that would give AX, then BY, then what? Wait, what would happen after that? So C, and there's nothing left. So would it throw an error? No. Would it take X again? Would it just make it XY, XY? Would it do that? Well, you'll have to see. So let's try to run it and see what happens. So this is very useful when you're parsing two lists and you want to kind of combine them in some format. So this is also a pretty useful function, similar to how the zip function works. Let me comment this part out. So remember that if you notice carefully, I didn't point it out, there was an optional argument, which is fill value. It is not pointed out here, but see here, there is an optional fill value argument. Let's see how that works. Okay. So what are we doing here? This is num. So these are seven numbers and these are three characters. So when we say zip longest, you get 1T, 2E, 3A, and then what? So what happens after that? Let's see. So we get none, 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 none. And this happens basically because it was not able to find anything to map 4 with, or 5, 6, or 7. So this could be a bit undesirable. You don't want this none here. Maybe you want some default value or something else instead of none. Maybe you want a 0. So you just want 4, 0, 5, 0, 6, 0, 7, 0, or anything like that. So the fill value argument comes to your rescue in such a situation. So what it does is it provides a default value that you can attach when it does not find a matching argument. So here it is the underscore. So you would have 1T, 2E, 3A, and then what? Then you would have 4 underscore, 5 underscore, 6, and 7, similar. Let's do it. Oh, wait. In X, okay, there was a mistake in the code. It should be no. Yep, all good. So this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, as expected. Let me actually edit this before. Wait, didn't have. Okay, so we're good now. So that's about zip longest. So that's pretty much about how you can learn the language. You've kind of learned this whole module from scratch. That's all about, that's all it is pretty much. These are the same functions explained in detail. And that's it. So you've learned an entire module from scratch without having known anything about it before. And this is actually a very useful thing that you would use in your projects and tutorials. So remember, keep these in mind and actually use it. So that's when you, so now you know that something like this exists. Okay, a quick to conclude, let me also show you some of the other resources that exist apart from documentation. That would actually be more helpful from a learning point of view. So till now, I hope there are no questions. And anyway, if there are, Slido is the place to ask those questions. Okay, so speaking of asking questions, there is this wonderful thing called Stack Overflow that was probably pointed out previously as well. So let me kind of show you how you would just like to learn something very vague. So let's say that I want to, so again, I just pointed this out as well. You don't have to remember how to do everything. So the internet is always there. Okay. So let's say I want to send out emails using Python. This is just a vague idea. So I have to send out, let's say I'm a TA for a course and I want to send all my students their marks individually as a mail. So to do it manually would be stupid, right? So let's say I'm learning Python now. So I'd like to send out mails using Python, but I don't know anything else about it. So I just Google how to send an email with Python. And this is a Google search. You can just click on it or Google it yourself. What happens then, you would see a Stack Overflow result pop up invariably. And when you open it, you get something interesting. You get someone, Stack Overflow works, someone asks a question. Typically providing their own work on that topic. So if they have attempted it. So again, asking homework questions and stuff like that, or asking questions without putting your own, showing your effort or showing your work is extremely frowned upon. And you would be showered with downvotes if you do something like that. So in a way, Stack Overflow is not very welcoming to newcomers, but there are a lot of questions already asked. So you will find almost all the stuff you need. Right. The question is how to send an email with Python, and someone has added this and they get so and so error. So very often you would see someone in the comments on the answers providing the corrected code or resources that would help you provide a corrected code. So for example, this person has suggested that you use so and so these standard packages. So again, my question was a couple of minutes back, I didn't know what to do. I don't know anything about how to send email using Python. Now I have a foundation. Now I have a couple of packages. And now I can use documentation and try to understand how to do it better. Okay. If I just type, went to documentation and type, how do I send emails using Python? I'm not going to get anything. Probably end up getting gibberish. So this is how you can use Stack Overflow to get some of these keywords. Sometimes you might get ready-made code in the answers. Obviously, don't plagiarize for academic stuff. But many times, the best way to learn is to get these package names or library names and then go and look it up on documentation yourself. So in fact, he says that this example is from the Python documentation, which helps. Okay. So this helps. If you open the documentation, you will see this. And it tells you how to send. So it tells you how to enter the subject, from, to, and so on. And then there are modifications as well. Very often, you would find more optimal solutions. So this is using an API, which is much more convenient, apparently. There are other packages as well that you can look for. So you'll find a lot of interesting solutions to your problems. But again, in the context of documentation, why I wanted to bring this up is because many times you read these solutions, you might not understand everything, but you at least know where to look at. So you're wiser in that you know these package names. So that's how you would use Stack Overflow. There are many others. If I just go to Google search, you would find out some other useful resources. You find documentation comes up here, then you would have Stack Overflow. Some of these other resources might be useful, but you can certainly get, you're guaranteed to get help at documentation as well as Stack Overflow. So these are the two sources that you should look for finding most of your solutions. Okay, so with that, we've pretty much come to the end of what we want to do today. So just a quick motivation for what we're going to do next time, which is going to be very exciting. And we're actually delving into the real depths of Python as our developers actually use it. So you would interact, so some of the things, so you would learn about the Python standard library tomorrow or in the next class, where you would actually start doing real world stuff, not just adding numbers and, you know, doing stuff like that you would not actually use in real life. So you would interact with files, so you would actually accept files, read them, write to them, and do stuff like that. This is very interesting thing called Picklick, which is to do with objects, and you would learn what this is next time. Math functions, we've seen some of them sporadically, but this is something that you would learn more about. Random numbers, if you're in any engineering application, it's very likely that you would need random numbers, and we haven't looked at any way to do that. Not something we're going to cover in too much detail, but how to interact with the internet. So this is a kind of like an example of how to interact with the internet. So you can actually send mails from your Gmail ID without actually opening your Gmail. So you can interact with the internet through Python, through your command line or your Jupyter Notebook interface. And GUI. So this is also a pretty advanced topic that we won't be covering too much, but the Python standard library is a starting point for literally anything that you want to do productive with Python. Okay, so with that, I'm going to end. And yeah, that's it. Thank you for sticking around, how many other people there were. If you have any questions, we can, I'll just stop sharing my screen. Yeah, if we have any questions, we have like 10 minutes or something. So people can, I think, unmute or whatever, like raise their hand and ask. Otherwise, I hope there's nothing pressing from Slido, right? Guys who are monitoring Slido?
No, all questions have been answered.
Yeah, so again, if people have questions, you can raise your hand and unmute yourself and speak. And we can stick around for probably 2-3 minutes more, otherwise we can end the meeting.
Okay, so there is a question about projects. So about projects, like we have mentioned before, you can team up with 3 more people at most, but you can also do the project solo. The project can be anything that you do with Python, like whatever idea you have, maybe you need to do something in research or something you just want to try out. You can pick any topic. We'll also